humans, you know, I think that this, I think many of these ancient practices that induce heightened states of awareness evolved out of strategies, unique human strategies for survival and reproduction, but then they become fascinating on their own. Exercise is one of them. Another one that I'm particularly interested and involved with is psychedelics, right? So if you say, well, what's another thing that humans all around the world did repeatedly and for extended periods to alter consciousness? It's psychedelics. It goes, it's much older than just humans. You know, mammals have a tropism, a craving for drugs that make them hallucinate and go crazy. You can make a list. Many mammal species have their psychedelics. Cats have catnip. Elks have their, it's amazing, a certain kind of moss. So there's something about mammalian brains that are drawn to substances that induce these sort of altered states of consciousness. And widespread use of psychedelic medicines, psychedelic substances around the world. And you know, you say, well, what do these things do? Well, they tap into this interesting human evolved capacity for transcendent states, you know, that can be induced in all sorts of other ways. And in one of the most species typical human behaviors is trying to put yourself in a whacked state, you know, a trance state. Dancing, yeah. I mean, there's a whole list of these things. And the urgency with which these were pursued in indigenous groups is really highlighted nicely by people that were indigenous in my part of the world, which is up about 200 miles from here. I grew up in Fresno in Central California. And prior to them all being wiped out, the Yokuts that were the indigenous group in Central California were very, they were one of the world's great shamanistic cultures. But they didn't have good psychedelic substances. And so they felt so strongly about the need to induce these types of experiences at puberty that they would have their young people at puberty, you know, strip naked and lay on these anthills, and their bodies would be completely covered with ants and bitten. And the ants, I don't know whether it was formic acid, I'm not sure what it was, but there's a substance that if you get, you know, just hideously bitten, it will induce a psychedelic experience. I mean, that's the length.
That's crazy.
Yeah, that's the length people would go to induce these experiences because they were so integrated into certain societies.
Why did they do it for, why puberty? Why is this, was it like a coming of age kind of
yeah.
thing with it?
Well, in cultures that have a strong shamanistic emphasis, there's a very powerful feeling that you want to identify a spirit guide for a lifetime. So, you know, psychedelic experiences or transcendent, trance-like experiences on a repeated basis were usually just the province of a very small group of specialists, shamans, that had very complex relationships with the rest of the population, very ambivalent. It's fascinating stuff. But most of these cultures, everybody would at least have one experience, and if that happened, it would be at puberty. And yeah, I think basically that's the time where you sort of have a transcendent experience that orients you to the spirit world so that you can have, you know, you're not going to have the same potency of spirit guide help that you'd have if you're constantly moving into the spirit realm like a shaman would. But it was sort of, people would, you know, everybody sort of wants one of these in those sort of cultures. And so I think that's why they were used there. Now there's some evidence that the Eleusinian mysteries of ancient Greece, which we know very little about because they were all kind of hush-hush, but there's some suggestion now, I think in the last 20, 30 years, some research has suggested that they may have also ingested psychedelic substances. That was sort of at the core, because these were really the core of spirituality, especially esoteric spirituality, in the Greco-Roman world, you know, and we know so little about them because they were so secret, but they were very widespread. Another example of these things being used, not just at puberty, but for these sort of transformational purposes. And I know you were off camera, you told me you interviewed my colleague Roland Griffiths.
Yeah.
And so a number of us are now involved in this work of looking really rigorously at psychedelic substances as treatments for depression.
Right.
Because Roland and Steve Ross at NYU, Roland at Hopkins, showed that, you know, a single exposure to something like psilocybin, which is a psychedelic substance in magic mushrooms, you know, tends to induce these very unusual states of mind that often have a kind of mystical characteristic to them. A single exposure in a couple of studies induced these powerful antidepressant responses that last for like 6 months, longer. I mean, I know from Steve, you know, that he's followed up with people. These are depressed, anxious people with cancer, that those are still alive 2 years later. Many of them, most of them, are still undepressed. Not taking
after one experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's profoundly life transforming. Oh, it's fascinating.
Yeah, I mean,
it's one of the most fascinating things going in our world right now.
I know with my discussion with Dr. Griffiths, he was mentioning again. He did say that this mystical experience seemed to be important for for the antidepressant effect. And of course, he doesn't really know the mechanism why. But parallel to that, there are also some studies looking at part of the brain that's involved in like rumination. Mm-hmm. I forgot what it was called.
Default mode network.
Yes, the default mode network. And how that was like changed also.
Oh, absolutely. Yes.
And of course, rumination, that's a big part of depression.
Huge, huge part. And it's interesting to link back. There's studies linking rumination, particularly, to inflammation.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So inflammation probably preferentially drives rumination. We know from the interferon studies that one of the places that inflammatory molecules most change in the brain is the rumination center in the anterior, dorsal anterior cingulate, right? So there's a beautiful sort of story there. Now, why you should ruminate when you're, that's an interesting question that I don't think we know the answer to. Why should inflammation make you ruminate? But it does. And yes, rumination is a big problem.
Yeah, and that also sort of leads to you're talking about these transformative experiences, which also, you know, are brought about by meditation. Mm-hmm. And I know there seems to be, at least Roland was talking about some overlap between meditative state and this, something that's happening with this mystical experience that's, you know, there's sort of mystical experiences are like the common denominator.
Oh, yes, absolutely. It's very much like sauna versus my $50,000 fancy machine, right? It's not the machine, it's the heat, right?
Uh-huh, right.
I am utterly convinced it's not the psychedelic. We know it's not the psychedelic, it's the experience, because we know every study pretty much that's looked at this shows that the more intensely you have one of these sort of mystical type experiences, and depending how you define mystical, there's other ways. Spiritual is almost a better word, because people also have these very difficult personal experiences, but that it makes them feel like their life, they see their life in a different way that produces a transformation. They get, you know, that realm of response has just been repeatedly associated with antidepressant and anti-anxiety effects. And not just that, but also these agents seem to have an anti-smoking effect. You help people quit smoking.
Yeah.
You see the same thing there, right? So we think that exactly. There's nothing special about the psychedelics other than the fact that they can take a wide range of people and on cue induce these sorts of experiences. You know, just like if you want to study inflammation, it's great to have interferon, because I could just wait around until you got inflamed, you know, God forbid. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to wait, you know, or I could just give you an interferon shot and away you go, right? Mm-hmm. So in the same way, I could wait around for you to have mystical experience. And there was a wonderful study done a number of years ago that I unfortunately wasn't smart enough to put in my file. I just read about it, where they did this huge sort of, you know, anonymous survey of Americans, and I don't know, some crazy percent, 15-20% of people said, I've had a powerful mystical experience that changed my life. Mm-hmm. I just never talk about it. I was at the kitchen sink, you know, and boom, the world looked like it was, you know, interconnected in ways I'd never imagined. You know, so it happens, right? Mm-hmm. But it doesn't happen predictably, whereas, you know, I believe me, if it wasn't illegal and unethical, I could give you a big old dose of psilocybin right now, put you on the couch over there, and, you know, it'd be very likely you'd have a profound, you know, mystical experience, right?